Welcome to everybody. My name is Kees Reisdijk. I'm president of the Astronaut Society of Southern Africa. Before I go any further, please can we turn off our cell phones. And I'll give a brief introduction for Phila. Phila graduated from the University of KwaZulu-Natal with a master's degree in environmental science. Based on his research there was finding cannabis amongst maize crops. Must have been an interesting to do. Please come in. He started his career at Umvoto Africa and subsequently joined SANSA as a remote sensing scientist. He developed a snow mapping algorithm using Landsat 8. In 2017, he joined the Science Observing Department of Space Agency of the South National Space Agency, promoting STEMI, that's Science, Technology, Engineering, Mathematics, and Innovation. He's involved in several committees and working groups promoting easy access to satellite data. And he's also interested in landscape photography, in his spare time with some soccer, reading, and off-roading. Sifo, Phila, rather, we look forward to hearing from you. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Afternoon, everyone. I hope I can make this talk quite interesting. And the talk is basically looking at the journey through the life of a satellite, but my talk will be based on our experiences in South Africa, the capabilities of building a satellite, putting it into space, and subsequently having the satellite to give us products that we can use for societal benefits. And the previous talk by Anna Marie is absolutely one of the greatest examples of how satellites can be beneficial to the society. And from the space agency, just like SSIR, we are also a subsidiary of the Department of Science and Technology. So all our budget comes from the Department of Science and Technology. And within the space, within SANSA, we have four directorates, of which I will explain how each one of those directorates are involved in the life cycle of a satellite. Because when you're building a satellite, that is absolutely one project that involves all of the departments, bring them together in building up the satellite. We have the space engineering department, which are involved in the development of the satellite. And then you have the space operation department, which are involved in launching the satellite and support while the satellite is in space. And we also have the space science, which is based in Hermanas, that are involved in monitoring outer space environment to ensure that we understand the environment at which the satellite exists in outer space. And then we have the Earth Observation Department, which is where I'm from now. At the Earth Observation, that's where we start making use of the products and the information that we receive from the satellite and develop different products for different stakeholders. And I will explain in each and every one of those departments how they are involved in the entire life cycle of a satellite. Now, there are different types of satellites, as some of you may know, but I'd like to focus on the three types of satellites that are commonly used in our everyday life. We have the navigation satellites, and I'm sure some of you, I myself, had to navigate to find this location. And during that process, I had to use satellite, because the moment you plug into a GPS, you're actually connecting to navigation satellite. And that is also an application of satellites. And the other types of satellites are communication satellites. As you are aware, when you're traveling or on a plane, you can actually make a call to people who are actually on the ground, and by so doing, actually making use of satellite. And yes, there are communication satellites. and that is the architecture of how the whole system is set up. You make a call from the plane, it just transmits it to the satellite and then relays it down to an antenna on the ground and subsequently send it to the recipient of the call. And you also have Earth observation satellites. These are satellites that are just placed in space to observe or look what is happening on the ground. Just like the previous speaker, the APHIS system uses Earth observation satellites where they have different sensors which might look at different features on the ground depending on the objective of the satellite, what it was built to look into space. So communication satellites, navigation satellites, and Earth observation satellites. But in my examples, I will speak more about the Earth observation satellite because that's a field I'm most comfortable on and I'm well vested in. So now, before you build a satellite, the first thing that one has to do is to find the ultimate use, the user's requirements, because you don't just build a satellite, send it into space and say, okay folks, we've built a satellite, see how you can use the information. So there's some engagement with the stakeholders and end users to ensure that the need satellite to whatever satellite that is being built, it has to answer certain questions or challenges that the end users are encountering or they're facing. So you gather the requirements from the end users. Then the second phase is to generate the concept or ideas, you know, around those requirements that have been submitted by the end users or the stakeholders of the entire program. Then the next phase is to look into those designs and all those things that have been discussed, and then see if they will definitely make sense. And then from there onwards, you design the satellite, I mean, you just look into the concept and you start manufacturing. But that is not all that is. Once you start building the satellite, you take it through some tests and then you fix whatever that is not right with the satellite, you continue building and testing. I'll also speak about the facilities we have in the country to build, I mean, to test some of these satellites. And once you are happy with the testing that you've taken the satellite through, then you deliver the product. But that is just not the end part of the entire building process, because there are certain questions that you need to ask yourself. And one of the questions is that, was the satellite built right? That's one of the questions that I normally ask after building the satellite. But the most important question is it, was the right satellite built? Because you need to go back into the requirements to find out whether is the satellite built still identifying or picking up or serving or answering those questions that were put forward by the end users. Now, assuming that this process ticks all the boxes and the end users are satisfied, the next phase is to launch the satellite. But let me take you through some of the facilities we have in the country during the testing of the satellite. We take through a certain number of tests. We do the sensor testing. The sensor testing is to actually identify or to see if the satellite is going to have the required resolution, which means will it be able to pick up a specific object on the ground as it has been put forward by the end users, to test the sensors if they will, for instance, identify, make an example with the previous speaker, to identify fires within, you know, 60 or 90 meters, would they be able to pick up fires within that kind of a range? Then you take them through an acoustic chamber testing, because sound in its nature is very destructive. And when you're launching a satellite, the rocket on its own makes a lot of noise. So you don't want the satellite to disintegrate what is exposed to, you know, a lot of sound. And the same thing applies to the vacuum chamber, where you shake the satellite vigorously to ensure that the shaking that is going to undergo through during the launching, it will still remain intact. And of course, once all of that is done, you take it through integration and assembly. Then you start integrating the satellite together with the rocket. And then after that, you then send the satellite for launching. Now, when you launch the satellite, depending on the use of the satellite, you take it to different orbits. And there are quite a number of orbits, but I'd like to focus on the on only these three orbits. You have the low Earth orbit, which is where most of the Earth observation satellites are, including the AFIS satellites, and also the International Space Station is found on the low Earth orbit. And then you can also have the medium Earth orbit, where you find the navigation satellites, the one I spoke about earlier. Then you find the geostationary satellites, where you normally find communication satellites and weather satellites. So these are some of the most common orbits where we take satellites into these different orbits. Now, when the satellite is launched, then that's where the space operations, SANSA Space Operation Unit, kicks in, which is based 60 kilometers northwest of Pretoria in Hartbeespoort. That's where we have our ground receiving stations. During the launch, the space operations taps into the rocket and do what we call TTNC, telemetry tracking and command, to ensure that we track the rocket while it's launching the satellite in space. It is following the right trajectory. And then we also do launch and end orbit support, and also do transfer orbit support. So while it's still in space, you still need to, you know, get constant communication with the satellite to ensure that it is still performing as expected. Just like when us humans are not feeling well, we go to a doctor, get diagnosed, and subsequently we get medication. Same thing applies with the satellite. When it is in space and it passes over our airspace, we log into the satellite, we do some commands to ensure that the satellite, it is still within its orbit and is following the right projection. And if there's something wrong, we still send commands to make sure that we correct that projection and we correct that orbit. And all of that is done at our space operations unit in Hartbeespoort. Now, at HBK, we call it HBK because to pronounce Hartbeespoort sometimes can be tongue twister. So we just say HBK. So HBK is found right there at that point, and this is the radius. Anything inside that circle, any satellite passing over that circle, we are able to detect that satellite. Anything 10 degrees out of the equator, any satellite passing within the range, we're able to detect that satellite. Now, what do I mean by that? These are some of the launching facilities around the world. We've got Cape Canaveral, Vandenberg, and then Baikonur. So any satellite or rocket that is being launched at Cape Canaveral, it will subsequently pass through this circle. So we'll be able to detect that satellite and provide support to any rocket launch in Cape Canaveral. Same thing applies to Vandenberg and also beyond. But we cannot detect a satellite or rocket launch in Baikonur because the projection, the trajectory followed by that rocket does not fall within our airspace. So during that process, you are able to detect the satellite and actually provide support to all rockets that are being launched in all of those three areas. And all of those is being done at our space operation program. And then now, once the satellite is in space, we're able to track it and detect it and send commands and communicate with the satellite. Then our space science department in Hermanus, which is the only magnetic space weather center in Africa that actually monitors outer space environment, because the Earth is protected from solar radiation by the magnetic field. So what happens is space science, they monitor, you know, the activities around our magnetic field. And through that, they're able to send information and focus about that situation around concerning the magnetic field. If you might be might have been aware that I think last week there was a large ball of energy, they call it solar flares or coronary mass ejection from the sun. So we were able to detect that and try to send a forecast and try to make sure that owners of satellites and aeroplanes are made aware, because what happens is the positively charged particles that leave the sun, actually when they enter our atmosphere, in our ionosphere, just above our atmosphere, they interact with particles within that range. So if satellites are transmitting information towards the Earth, it passes through the ionosphere before they reach the ground. So if we have those coronary mass ejections, you know, affecting the ionosphere, anything passing through the ionosphere will be affected. So that's why it is very important, because it can also affect navigation, can also affect even the aeroplanes, because while they travel, they use, you know, navigation satellites. So it is very much important for space science to provide those forecasts on a daily basis to ensure that every services that make use of satellites are made aware. So once again, there was a satellite built by South Africa, launched in 2009 in Kazakhstan, Sumbandila Set. It stayed in space for 3 years, and it was affected by a solar storm. Now, it is that very energy that affected the satellite, because what happens is it hit the satellite, but it did not have enough time to react to that solar storm. So it affected one of the axes in the satellite, because you have the X, the Y, and the Z for shifting the satellite to left, right, and up. So it affected one of the axes in the satellite, so it started to circulate the Earth looking only on one direction. Could not control the satellite on the left or right. So now that, as the previous speaker said, satellites normally get their powers from the solar, from the sun. So the solar panels were shifted away from the sun, so they could not get sufficient light to repower, you know, the system on board. So subsequently, it ran around, and then the entire power within the satellite ran out. So that's how we lost the satellite in space, because it started from a solar flare, but it did not have enough time to react to the solar flare, and then it lost the power because of the solar flare affecting the solar panels. So once the satellite is in space, it starts capturing images. That is if it is the Earth observation satellite. It starts capturing images, but the question is, what do we use these satellite images for? There are different end users to the satellites, and the Earth observation uses them for different applications. This is just a simple process and architecture of how the satellite performs, because there are different types of satellites. You have satellites that works exactly like our eye. They need the light for the satellite to detect what it is on the ground. So it just requires the sun, and of course this would be the satellite. The energy leaves the sun and it interacts with the atmosphere. It could be water vapor, it could be dust particles, but subsequently it reaches the air. Now, certain things happen when the light interacts with the air. One, the light can penetrate through the object, means it is transmitted through. Secondly, the light can be reflected back into the atmosphere, or the light can be absorbed by the object. For instance, if one is feeling cold, you normally go out and get heated by the sun, so your body is absorbing some of the light. So a certain percentage of the light returns back into the atmosphere. So that is the light energy that is absorbed by the sun and recorded by the satellite. Now, during that process, depending on the type of satellite, if it is a communication satellite, we can relay the information to another satellite. We just had the Olympics, the Brazilian Olympics last year, and Nick Farnicket broke the world record. We were able to appreciate that very moment when he broke the record, because we use satellite technology. The satellite that was in line of sight with Brazil transmitted the information from the ground to the satellite looking on the other side of the globe, and related to a satellite which we're able to connect to. And then, during that moment, that information was relayed back into our respective DS television. So now, the same thing applies here. That information that has been captured on the Earth, it is transmitted to another satellite, but subsequently it ends up in our ground receiving station in Hartbeespoort. When that information is transferred to there, it is taken through different scientists now to extract the information that is required by different stakeholders, whether it is farming, which is, you know, aphids or disaster management or any other applications. This is the ideal process. So when that is being processed, the end products are developed. So once that is done, you can start sending to our different stakeholders. Satellites, Earth observation satellites in their nature, they take pictures and they provide the information based on their resolution. Basically, it is the detail of the features you can see on the ground. We have different satellites in space. We've got Landsat, which has a 30 meter resolution, which means anything bigger than 30 meters, you can be able to detect. Anything smaller than 30 meters, you cannot pick up using the satellite. We've got Sumbandila at 6.25 meters, we had Spot 5, now we've got 6 and 7 Spot. We are able to pick up things, objects on the ground, about 2.5 meters, and quite a number of other satellites in space. Now, the fact that we have a satellite, just like beards, which is about 50 centimeters, can pick up something as small as 50 centimeters, it does not make the other satellites irrelevant. It depends on the area that you're focusing on. If you're looking at a nationwide, you know, extent, a 30 meter or a 1 kilometer satellite is actually appropriate. But if you're focusing on a locality area like a small farm, this would be an ideal satellite to use. So when you look at the different applications of satellites, because just like Landsat, it navigates or comes to the same point around the Earth every 15 days. So with satellites taking pictures every now and then, they're able to go back in history and look at a specific point, how that area looked like, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago. And in this case, this was a change detection analysis where we looked at the development of settlements in a specific, in a certain area between 2008 and 2012. So you see the developments within this area. And also, we used our satellites and Earth observation, the satellite data, to look at drought monitoring. When there is a drought, subsequently, if they declare it a disaster, they must have taken certain things into consideration, certain data set into consideration. But before they can declare a drought a disaster, you need to look at certain parameters that would indicate that you're heading toward a drought situation. It's not a catastrophic event, it's not something that happens now. So you need to monitor it over time. So we correlate all of those satellite images until you come up to a situation where you say you have a drought situation. However, you don't only look at the vegetation condition, you look at the temperature, you look at the rainfall. And then when you look at all of those parameters and they correlate with each other, that's when you come up to a situation where you say, we're in a drought situation. And all of those is possible with the satellites that you make use of. And then also, being a water scarce country is very critical to also use some of the satellite to monitor our water resources. This is a dam in Emalahleni, Witbank, in 2008. Just that's a black and white image, but that is the dam. So 4 years later, that was the dam within the area. And then 2 years ago, that was the situation. So these are some of the applications that you make use of the satellite. However, as a space agency, what we do, we don't take decisions because there are certain government departments that are mandated to take actions. Our job is to look into the situation and see what are the implications and what are the features or things that we see, and then we pass it over to the relevant department so that they can make informed decisions about some of the information that we can see using the satellites. Not only do we use them in water resource monitoring, also in snow mapping. This was a situation in the Western Cape where we picked up snow in the mountains. As you can see, that we're able to pick up those snow. And this is also an important feature for water, especially in the Western Cape being a water scarce province. And this is one of the applications at which we able to pick up. Well, I won't go much into fire as Lee has delved much into it, but also this was just Landsat data set where we looked at the feature and the area before the fire, and then that is a burn scar map, a burn scar. But subsequently you just classify the image and pick up only the burnt area to quantify how much of the area that was affected by the fire. Now, one might ask, how is this important? It could be important on two parts. One can be important for the person affected or the company affected when they're making claims for insurance, because the insurance company would like to know how much of your land was affected by the fire. On the other side, the insurance company would come to us and wants to confirm whether what you've submitted to them is it actually what you have actually submitted. So you might be in the middle, but you can provide the same information to two different parties, and they will serve two different purposes, for claiming and also for verification. So this is also some of the applications. And of course, in agricultural monitoring, you look at what's happening in the fields. In this area, the field was being prepared for planting in October, November. The field was already being planted, and then in February and March, the field was already, you know, the crops were doing well. However, I'd like us to focus on this field here. When you look at this field, that part of the field is not uniform as the rest of the field. Now, if you're on the ground looking, you know, into the field, you won't be able to see that part of your field is not performing very well. So by using the satellite and geoanalysis, you'll be able to see that something is definitely happening in the field. It could be one of three things. It's either it's water shortage, it's pest infestation, or fertilizer deficiency. Now, a smart farmer will definitely consult with us and we'll actually tell him to go investigate what is happening in that field, so he can take immediate action. If it's water shortage use, you take the right action. It is pest infestation, you put the right pesticides. And if it's fertilizer deficiency, you put the appropriate fertilizer to make sure that at the end of the day you get to maximum and expected yield. And as this farmer did, he took the right steps, and subsequently you get the expected yield from that. The same thing applies when you are doing crop yield estimates. You use the satellite technology once again, because you can calculate the hectares of the field. Now, with that information, what you see here is the long-term minimum yield over the past, say, 4 or 5 years. And then the other one, it is the long-term maximum over the past 5 or 6 years. And then this dotted line is the current performance of your vegetation, the current performance. So historically, it tells us that you can never go below this line, you can never go above that line in the past 5 years. But when you look at the current performance of your crops, they've outweighed the long-term maximum in the past 5 years. So what this means is that you're expecting to have a better yield this year than the previous 5 years. And all of those is possible through the usage of satellite and calculating actually your hectares and how much biomass you have on the ground. And all of those is possible because of the satellite. That's why we build satellites, because as much as we don't see them, they have a lot of influence on how we make decisions. And that kind of a decision can actually determine whether we need to import maize or we need to export maize in terms of food security as well. So these are some of the applications that we use satellites for. And these are some of the applications and projects that are involved in the space agency in the life cycle of the satellite. And I thank you.
Thank you very much. Very good. Do we have some questions? Are you shy? Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, when satellites are built, normally they have between the 5 and 10 years life cycle, and before that life cycle, you start developing the next satellite. But in most cases, we've seen with one of the best satellite series, the Landsat, they've built about Landsat 7 and 8, but we still have Landsat, I think 5 data coming through. So, but they take them through. They build them to last about 5 years, 6 and 7, but some of them, they survive way longer than that. Yes, but that's one of the biggest problems, because like our Sumbandila, it lasted for only 3 years. So it just becomes, space debris. So what happens is, hopefully when it does comes back into our Earth, it will burn out through re-entry into our atmosphere. And if some parts of it, doesn't completely burn out, hopefully it doesn't fall on one of, our houses or our heads. Because there are some cases where, certain debris survive the re-entry, But I think moving forward, like the Spot 5, it was deorbited, and through the deorbiting phase, they had to calculate exactly where it had to, land on Earth towards the ocean. So I think moving forward, satellites would be designed in such a way that when they reach the end of, that they reach their lifespan, they deorbit them to ensure that we reduce space debris.
I think quite a lot of technology now is moving towards planned life, and they say, well, this satellite's going to last that long. Before that period is up, they can start deorbiting it so it lands in the Pacific Ocean or the Atlantic Ocean or something like that. So these things are now built in as far as they can. But in the past, I think 2002, I think it was, I picked up all the space debris that landed just outside Cape Town, which is now the display of the Science Center in Cape Town. But it does come down. And it's fortunately, I don't think we've had any serious accidents yet.
No, not yet.
Yes?
I would like to know the different satellites that are sending
signals
to
in the satellite?
No.
Will they interfere with each other?
Can I
interfere
with
No. No. The sensors on board, they don't affect each other. It could be one sensor with multiple filters, or it could be separate cameras, because we call it a satellite, but ideally it's just a powerful camera in space, so it can have multiple sensors with different filters. Could be an ultraviolet, a thermal, but they work independently, they are not interfering with each other as they are on board.
Anyone? Yes.
Is there an organization that you have to apply to pull the satellite and send it up to avoid too many things going up?
Yes.
And how long does that application take? And then once your application comes through, is the satellite still viable? Is it a quick process or is it a long process?
Honestly, as from my position, I would not have the right answer, but I believe that you wouldn't just launch it, because I believe if you're buying a plot, they wouldn't sell you a vacant plot. you must have, they wouldn't sell you a plot which is built up, you need a vacant plot. So you, I think you would apply, they will tell you, okay, you need to launch it at this orbit at this time so that you make the precise measurement and even the launch time, so that when you launch it, it does not come in contact with other space debris and you launch it at the precise, you know, orbit. And I think definitely there should be an organization where you contact them and to say you want to launch a satellite. They wanna know, I think, for what purpose, and because of that purpose, they'll also probably determine which orbit you need to place your satellite on, because the use of the satellite also determines the orbit at which that satellite has to be at.
NASA has a catalog of four objects with one dimension more than 15 centimeters or 6 inches. So this catalog is there, and you do apply. There are space laws as well. So you want to avoid damaging your satellite on the way up, so you need opportunities and all that sort of stuff. It's quite a complex process.
Is there a United Nations body that tries to control the overall picture?
I think it's the United Nations Office of Outer Space Affairs that deals with those kind of issues. UN USA.
Anything else? Yes.
Has a South African satellite ever failed due to a software problem? Software related problem.
Not to my knowledge. In the five satellites we've built so far, none, because even Sumbandila was a technical problem. We could not do anything about in space, hardware related because of the solar flare, but software related, I think we have so far the capacity well covered, and the history of satellite building haven't encountered such a problem.
In connection with these solar, these massive coronal mass ejections in 1989, the whole of Quebec was shut down through one of those solar outbursts. So there can be, we now have warnings, and we can turn satellites to put a dead side towards it. But it's quite a process. Anything else? Well, once again, thank you very much, Phila. That's very good.
Okay.
Small talk of our appreciation. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. The next talk here is at almost 2 this afternoon.